Now, when you were listening to Daniel, what you wouldn't have noticed, for fairly obvious reasons, is that he has hearing aids. He was born deaf and so wouldn't have been able to hear his parents properly for quite some time, which also affected his ability to speak, until eventually they tested his hearing and it was discovered that he needed hearing aids. And we can still remember the look of sheer joy on his face the day he had his hearing aids fitted and was able to hear his mum and dad properly for the first time. For him, it was like a miracle, and it's made such a huge difference to his life. In the same way, if we are to hear from God our Father, we need the Holy Spirit to open our spiritual ears. Otherwise, when we read God's word or hear it being preached, it will literally fall on deaf ears. But when God's Spirit opens our ears, it makes all the difference in the world. So what about when we speak to God? Prayer is meant to be a two-way conversation between us and our Heavenly Father, which means that we must learn to listen to God as well as speak to him. To quote Dietrich Bonhoeffer, just as a child learns to speak because his father speaks to him, so we learn to speak to God because God has spoken to us and speaks to us. We need to listen to God first. That's the secret of prayer. And just to remind you, there should be a list of prayer items at the end of this order of service, and I encourage you to use that list for prayer, either now or later, or both. Let's sing a song now, asking God to open our eyes and our ears so that we can see Jesus. Open my eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. Okay, let's now watch the Transformed Living video for this week.
Hello and welcome to session 4 of Transformed Living. I'm here with Dave Smith, Senior Pastor of Kingsgate Community Church, and let me read the passage for this week to us, taken from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 through to 14. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But among you there must not be a hint of sexual immorality, or of any kind of impurity, or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For of this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a person is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things, God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be partners with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes a light. That is why it is said, "Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." So, Dave, what would you say is the main theme that we have in this passage here?
Well, I think the starting point is this wonderful idea that we are to be imitators of God.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've seen it, how children love to imitate adults. I remember when our daughter Annabelle was young, she absolutely was fascinated by one of her primary school teachers, and she'd come back at night and she would almost rehearse the events of the day, and she would act out what it meant to be the teacher. So she would do the register, she would scold the other children. And as she started growing up, we asked her, "Annabelle, what would you like to become?" And she'd say, "I want to be a mummy, a driver, and a teacher." Well, she's now married, she's learned to drive, and she herself is a primary school teacher. Just that sense of the power of imitation. And I love what Paul's saying here. It says here in this version of the NIV, "Follow God's example." In the older version that we're going to be learning our memory verse from, it's "Be imitators of God." Mm. Be like God, because through Christ, he has transformed you from the inside out. And I love the motivation here. Not be like God, because you must, but be like God as dearly loved children and live a life of love. In other words, because you're loved, become like God. Not as in you suddenly become omniscient like God, but learn to be like God in living a life of love. It's glorious.
Wow. I think one of the things that struck me as I read this passage just now is Paul's emphasis and quite strong language around the whole theme of sexual immorality. Why do you think this is so key to the Apostle Paul in this passage?
I think there's a culture thing, just like today. The culture of Ephesus at the time would have been riddled with all kinds of sexual immorality all around. There was all kinds of occult worship that fueled that. But also, I think there's something about the gift of sex. You know, it's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. But it's to be reserved, as we'll see in a short while, a couple of weeks' time, it's to be reserved within marriage. There's something about sex that's so holy. It's about the union between a man and a woman. And Paul's saying, don't mess with it. I believe it's strong, whether we're married or single. He's saying, don't misuse this precious gift.
That's great, Dave. Just as I was going through it earlier, another thing that struck me in verses 5 and following, Paul says, "For of this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a person is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things, God's wrath comes upon those who are disobedient." Quite strong language.
Very
again.
Strong. Yeah.
Does it mean, is Paul saying that if we do wrong, if we mess up, if we do sin, we somehow lose our salvation?
No, thankfully, not at all. I mean, he spent enormous time in the first three chapters laying out the foundation of who we are in Christ. And then from last week we saw chapter 4 verse 30 that we have been sealed with the Holy Spirit until the day of redemption. In other words, God has marked us with the seal. We belong to him, and I believe that reassures us. You know, God is not here wanting to suddenly unsettle us and help us to feel insecure, but on the other hand, he's a good God, he's a holy God. And just like, you know, if my children were going to mess up, I'd want to warn them. You know, I mean, if you know someone, you love them, and they're about to jump off a cliff, you're not just going to say, bye. you're going to want to grab them. You say, don't do it. This is dangerous.
Yeah.
And I believe there is a strength of warning here.
Yeah.
Sin is dangerous. It'll mess you up.
Yeah.
Sexual immorality, greed, idolatry, it'll mess you up.
Yeah.
And I think some of the strength of it is not saying if we sin, we can't be forgiven. That's clearly against the rest of the New Testament.
Mm.
You know, 1 John 1 talks about how in reality, even Christians still sin sometimes.
Mm.
And there's the glorious promise that if we confess our sins,
yeah.
He's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So there's always a way back. What I believe this is talking about is not so much occasional sin or weakness. What he's talking here about is a whole lifestyle, an orientation away from God.
Okay.
About continual practice where somebody says, in effect, I don't want God's will for my life.
Yeah.
I'm just going to go my way.
Mm.
And I believe the warning is strong. Will not have an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. And there may be some sense in which is saying right now, in this life, you're not going to enjoy the Christian life if you're living in sin.
Mm.
I remember years ago using an illustration. I don't think you've ever tried to do the splits. Pretty painful. And Christians sometimes can be conned by their culture and their own selfishness and friends around to almost end up like feet in both camps. I'll be, you know, go a bit with Christ, but I'll carry on doing what everyone else does and what I used to do.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, they have one foot and they hear a word and they're, you know, one, their leg goes one way and then they hear the pull the other way. I want to tell you, it'll do you some damage doing the splits.
Yeah. Yeah.
And what Paul's saying is going to do you some damage. It's going to mess up your Christian life now.
Yeah.
But then also there is that sense of somebody who consistently goes against God's will. There is the whole sense of the wrath of God and judgment to come. Strong stuff.
In verse 8 of chapter 5, Paul kind of transitions and starts now talking about darkness. He's talking about light. And he says this phrase, he says, now you are light in the Lord.
Yeah.
And what is he talking about? What does it mean for us to be light in the Lord?
What I love here is yet again, Paul is going back and reminding us what God has already done and who we already are before he goes on and teaches how to live. This is the pattern we saw previously, didn't we?
Yeah.
You're new, you're a new creation, now live like a new creation. Mm. So here he's saying, you are now light in the Lord. Therefore, live as children of light. You used to be darkness, the darkness of sin, the darkness of shame, the darkness of not knowing God. Now, the light has come on in your life, we might say.
Yeah.
Because you are living in Christ, who is the Lord of light and glory.
Yeah.
And he says, now look at what God's done in you. Now live like that.
Yeah.
Practically live like that.
Yeah.
When I was growing up, we had a massive, great big Georgian rectory. My dad was a vicar. And I remember going down into our cellar. And, you know, in that dark place, there were all kinds of bugs and creepy crawlies. But when you turn the light on, it exposes what's there. And I believe this is a kind of twofold thing here. First, it's a call for us as Christians. He's saying, you are now light.
Mm-hmm.
Don't go back into the shadows.
Mm-hmm.
Don't go back into the darkness. Don't go back into shame, doing stuff that you don't want anyone else to know about. Bill Hybels wrote a book a number of years ago saying, who are you when no one's looking?
Mm.
Strong, isn't it?
Yeah.
And he's saying, you know, don't do stuff in secret because that's not living in the light. Live in the light.
Yeah.
Live lives. You know, you're the same in public and you're the same in private.
Yeah.
Powerful stuff.
Integrity.
Exactly. So I believe it's a call to us to live as the light.
Yeah.
But then he almost goes on and he talks about almost us shining as lights.
Mm.
So I think there's a double thing going on here. If we as the Christians, if the church, if you like, gets revived, lives up to who they are and their new identity as people of the light, something's going to happen or emanate from us.
Mm.
And we're going to shine as lights into people who are walking in darkness. Now, this is not a question of us going around pointing the finger at either fellow Christians or people who don't yet know Christ. No, this is it. But I'll tell you, when you live in the light, the something of Christ that begins to almost like flow from you. The way you live is different to those around you. And I'm longing, I'm passionate. I believe Paul was passionate. The Holy Spirit's passionate for a church that lives in the light is going to almost like shine into the darkness.
Mm.
And there's men and women all around us who don't know Christ. They don't even know they need Christ. But I believe a revived church is going to shine as a light into a darkening world. And I'm praying and I'm believing, I know you are, many of us are, to see revived church and an awakening in our nation and the nations.
Amen.
Yeah.
Wow, fantastic. Dave, what's the memory verse for us this week as we conclude this study?
Okay, it's from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 to 2. It's the old NIV. It says this, "Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." Ephesians 5, 1 to 2.
We now come to our time of communion. If you have some bread and wine, or an equivalent, now is the time to have it ready. 2 weeks ago, you may remember, Martin used a cream cracker in place of bread. This morning, I'm using a muffin made by Sheldon's. No, not the Sheldons that immediately spring to mind, but rather Sheldons of Manchester, family bakers since 1949, which coincidentally was the year I was born. First, we're going to watch, and if you wish, sing along to the song, "How Deep the Father's Love for Us." I love this particular version, both the words and also the joy on the faces of the people singing, particularly when they sing the verse beginning, "I will not boast in anything." I must admit that by the end of the song, I usually have tears in my eyes. As you think deeply about the words of this song, may they help prepare you to take the bread and the wine.